Six Square is the governing organization over the 6 square miles of what used to be the Negro District here in Central East Austin.
It talks about the 1928 plan that separated African Americans and whites from the west side of 35 to the east side of 35.
Because there's a history that belongs specifically to this area that a lot of people don't know about. So preserving it is important, but there's also a history that's coming, a future that is coming and being built. So you also have to celebrate that and make room for that. So that's what I see as Six Square when I think about it.
We are a unique environment and a unique microcosm of a bigger world, because a lot of our history is living and breathing in our elders and the pioneers of East Austin.
You can go to a place such as the East Side and still see remnants of things that existed 50 years ago, 60 years ago, 70 years ago. Is it gone? No, it's still here. There's only the illusion that it's gone.
It is important for us as a community to remember our past, because our past speaks to our future. It speaks to our presence. Our past is our light.
My hopes for the future is that we can preserve and celebrate on the beautiful culture that once thrived here in Central East Austin. And we do that by bridging the gap between generations of our past and our future.
For us to admit that we have healing to do.
Learn about our stories.
We can't have a healthy community if you're only looking at yourself all the time.
If another organization is not winning, Six Square is not winning. We cannot quit, and that means we honor everybody in the community. This is Six Square.
Baseball, a timeless game with no clock. And if the weather's great, let's play two. The only game where the coach wears a uniform. The batter faces east, the fielders face west, and a left-handed pitcher is called a southpaw. And pitchers can throw a fastball. Old number one, four-seam, cross-seam, split, or they could throw the curve. Old 12-6 Blake. Old number two. And if he's good enough, he can hit a home run, a jack, a dinger, a four-base hit with all the classic names like Hammer and Hate, the Say Hey Kid, the Babe, the Yankee Clipper, Shoeless Joe. If you build it, he will come. Baseball, where a walk is spelled with a BB and a strikeout spelled with a K, and stealing is not a crime. It's a game of numbers, where failing 7 out of 10 times somehow makes you an all-star. Baseball, it's just a game. America's pastime. Neither white or black or brown. Baseball, where anyone can dream. It's the bottom of the ninth with the bases loaded. And we have a full count. And anyone can be a hero. And you can be saved. Coming home.
Hi, Pam. Hi, everyone. Welcome and thank you for joining us.
We are so excited to be here with you today to celebrate Downsfield. My name is Pamela Benson Owens, and I'm the executive director of Six Square. And let me tell you a little bit about Downsfield. Downsfield was once the football field for the LC Anderson High School Yellow Jackets. It has also served little leaguers and softball players and is now the proud home of the Houston Tillotson University Rams baseball team. And its significance goes far beyond Austin, as a place where the famous Negro League baseball players graced the field.
And I'm Chrissy Marty with Forklift Danceworks, and we make dances with people you don't think of as dancers. In 2014, we were invited by Six Square to create a show that celebrated the legacy of the field. So it was called Play Ball Downs Field. It starred the Houston Tillotts and Rams team and had the slam poets that you'll hear from later today. And the show featured the movement of baseball, pitching, catching, batting, all to music, and told the stories of people who had played there. We revamped a short version of this performance in February and had planned a series of community tailgates to get more people out to HT games this year. But even though we're not gathering there in person, we wanted to continue to share the stories and celebrate the field's legacy. So a lot of the oral histories we've been collecting will be donated to the Austin History Center and to the HT archives.
That is so great. And as part of this special project as well, we have photographer and visual artist Cindy Elizabeth. She's created visual arts envisioning the past, present, and future of Downsfield. Today, you'll experience an exclusive look at her artwork, as well as a premiere of a new poem by Alan Small and Scott Free.
Local historian Harrison Upright will ground us in some of the field's rich history and share an inspiring story of one of baseball's best players that you've never heard of. At 5 o'clock, we'll have a discussion with the artist and Harrison. So put your questions in the chat and hang out with us. But before we dive in, let's get warmed up. We have a special guest with us today to get us ready to go. Coach Simpson is going to let us in on some of the Rams training regimen and get us warmed up. Take it away, Coach.
Hi, I'm Coach Ryan Simpson with the Houston Tillotts and baseball team. I'm the pitching coach here. And today I'm gonna take you through a couple of the stretches that my pitchers do every single day before they pick up a baseball. Nothing crazy, nothing hard, basic motions to keep your body moving and get your arms loose. So the first thing that we're gonna do, is you're gonna take your right arm, cross your chest, arm across it, pull. After that, spread your feet apart a little bit, turn and stretch a little bit more into it. Hold that for about 10 seconds and shake it out. Take your left arm, do the same thing across your chest, right arm across it, pull till you feel a stretch. After that, spread out a little bit, turn into that stretch. And shake it out. Next thing, you're gonna take your right arm, you're gonna try to touch your center of your back. Left arm on top of it, pull down a little bit till you feel a nice stretch. For me, I got a pop, I pitched for a long time. After that, bend over a little bit and pull into that stretch a little bit more. Should stretch your whole right side. And shake it out. We're gonna switch arms, do the same thing with the left arm. Right arm on top of it, pull till you get a nice stretch. After that, bend over into that stretch. And shake it out. Next thing my guys do, it's an arm care circuit that we do every single day before they pick up a baseball, meant to get their arms loose before they ever pick up and actually throw. First stretch that we do, it's called POW. Just gonna hold it here for about 10 seconds. I'm gonna feel a little burn after about 5. Shoulders should be burning a little bit. After that, give me 2 fingers. You're gonna go with a throwing motion like a fastball. The big thing is keep your shoulders level. No elbows going up and down, all of that. We're gonna go straight forward, straight back at shoulder level for about 10 seconds. Already, I've been doing this for a long time, many, many years, and my shoulder's already burning. So here we go. Next thing we're gonna go through, we're gonna go same 2 fingers, turn them sideways. This is gonna simulate a curveball. You're gonna go with that same motion with your little curveball hooks. About 10 seconds of that. After that, we're gonna simulate a changeup. So give me an okay sign. Same up right here. You're gonna try to push these fingers towards your body. So I'm going here with that same motion. That's our POW circuit. Make sure my arms stay healthy, stay strong. Should feel a little bit looser. I'm Coach Ryan Simpson with Houston Tillotts and Baseball. Have a good one.
Thanks, Coach. I feel ready to go. How about you, Pam?
I'm definitely ready. Now let's get started. Grab some peanuts and some popcorn and your favorite drink, and let's head to the field. Harrison Upright, tell us about Downs Field.
Welcome to Downsfield. I'm Harrison Epright, Manager of Visitor Services and Tour Ambassador for Visit Austin. I am also tour docent for Six Square, Austin's Black Cultural District. And recently, I was tour docent at the Driscoll Hotel, Austin's oldest hotel. Downsfield is a gem, a jewel in the crown of Austin's culture, including Austin sports. Downsfield was first established in 1949 as a separate but equal field. Downsfield was located at the corner of East 12th and Springdale Road. After Downsfield was established in 1949, a number of Negro leagues continued to play at Downsfield until Downsfield had to relocate in 1954 in order to make way for the building of the Sims Elementary School, which now stands at the corner of East 12th and Springdale Road. Downsfield relocated to this location here at 2616 East 12th Street in 1954. It continued as a baseball field where Negro teams played. Today, it is the home team of the Houston Tillotson Rams University baseball team. It is their home field. Now, this particular site, even though this has been Downsfield since 1954, this site has actually been in existence since 1914. In 1914, this site was allocated as a site where black teams could play, black baseball teams. In 1920, the Samuel Houston College baseball team and their football teams played here on this site. And in 1938, L.C. Anderson High School, the only high school for African-American Austin students, started using this field. It continued to make a name for itself. In 1942, a man named Dick Night Train Lane played football on this field. And thanks to him, the L.C. Anderson High School won the 1942 Prairie View Interscholastic League Championship for the state. Teams continued to play on this field. That included teams such as the Austin Black Senators, the Austin Greyhounds, the Austin Black Indians, the Austin Palominos, just to name a few of the Austin teams that played here, as well as other teams connected with the Negro baseball leagues, including the Kansas City Monarchs, including the Homestead Grays, including teams that Willie Wells played on, which I'll talk to you more about Willie Wells. Now, also, in addition to baseball teams, Little League baseball teams played here, and also girls softball teams, including the Barbettes and their notorious rivals, the Red Devils. Among the noted players here that played at Downsfield would include Satchel Paige. Satchel Paige had a long distinguished career, a 24-year career in the Negro Leagues before he was signed in 1948 to play for the Cleveland Indians. And in fact, Satchel Paige also was the first black player to pitch in a World Series game when he pitched for the Cleveland Indians in 1948. And by the way, the Cleveland Indians won the World Series in 1948. Satchel Paige was also one of the best pitchers in baseball history, Negro Leagues and otherwise.
Hello, I'm Alan Small.
And I'm proud Houston Tillotson alum, Scott Free, go Rams.
This piece was performed at the 2014 performance of Play Ball Downsfield. It's about a legendary baseball player.
We performed it last February alongside Houston Tillotson pitching coach Ryan Simpson and catcher Alec LaFuente.
Now, we were rained out at Downs that day, so we performed it at Mapson Field. So now, here's the piece, and we hope you like it, Satchel Paige.
He was a black baseball player of the 40s. He pitched in 2,500 games, I think. Who really knows? He won 2,000 games or so, I guess. Nobody knows. And the number of strikeouts? It wasn't written down. They didn't keep stats on Negro League baseball. But the heroes are not made on details. Heroes throw and throw fast. Heroes throw peas at your knees and pokes at your yolk. They throw fire to have you swinging at smoke. The jump pitch, or the midnight rider, or the hesitation pitch, falling right into the catcher's mitt, just like he meant it. Heroes always live in that one time. Like that one time when he struck out one of the greatest hitters of all time on three straight pitches. Boom, boom, boom.
Whoa, 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 whoa. One of those pitches were fouled off. Or was it two? Well, heroes don't always get it right, like umpires or society, because being a black baseball player in the 40s, you had a life on and off the field. On the field, balls were fair or foul. Off the field, black players, black people were treated foul, but it was considered fair. On the field, success was runs, hits, and errors. Off the field, success was running, not being hit, and the only error of most was the color of their skin. Running home to be safe, being thrown out of restaurants or the front of buses. But the cheers, when on that field, it was the stuff of myth. And myths get nicknames. For when working as a porter in a railroad depot and carrying so many satchels, the name stuck. Or putting an I in page so that it would sound more high tone. Myths have self-confidence that defies the sun to go down on their head. They're described by words like crowd pleaser,
world shaker,
barnstormer.
From Chattanooga to New Orleans to Nashville,
from Birmingham to Cleveland, myths travel. All the while, myths don't look back. Something might be gaining on them. Part myth, part hero. A black baseball player of the 40s, gone. Gone, except for the stories and the cheers. Ladies and gentlemen, the great Satchel Paige!
What a great spoken word tribute to Satchel Paige. I just love the name Satchel. Satchel Paige is represented in a mural by Reginald Adams. In fact, these murals are by Reginald Adams. So we have Satchel Paige. We have Hilton Smith, who hailed from Giddings, Texas. Now, you might notice that this player looks a little different. Toni Stone was the first woman to play in the Negro Leagues. She has been called, quote, one of the best baseball players you never heard of, unquote, by the Negro League Players Association. Toni Stone was born Marcenia Lyle Stone and grew up in St. Paul, Minnesota. She played softball until she graduated from high school. When she switched to baseball, softball, she said, wasn't fast enough for her. Toni Stone often skipped school to play baseball. She also had skills in swimming, track, basketball, and football. In her youth, Toni Stone taught herself a lot about baseball by reading rule books. She played baseball in the Catholic Midget League, similar to the Little League, and then later in the Men's Semi-Professional League. She went on to play for the San Francisco Sea Lions, but she left after one season when she discovered that she was being paid less than the men on the team. Toni Stone then signed to play second base with the Indianapolis Clowns in 1953. During integration, attendance at Negro League baseball games started declining, and having a woman on the team would attract more fans. And so Sid Pollock, who was the owner of the Indianapolis Clowns, asked her to play in a skirt for sex appeal because they were trying to get people back to the games. She refused. Toni was traded to the Kansas City Monarchs, one of the most well-known and successful Negro League teams for the 1954 season. Buck O'Neill was her manager. She retired after one season because of lack of playing time. Toni was not accepted by male players with open arms. She was shunned because she was a woman. She was not allowed to change in the men's locker room. Instead, if she was lucky, she could change in the umpire's locker room. Toni was discriminated against because she was a woman. She was not liked by the male players. As she said, men just were not ready for her. For a period, though, she was fourth in the league in hitting. Following her baseball career, Toni moved to Oakland, California to be a nurse. She died November 2nd, 1996 in Alameda, California at the age of 75. In 1993, Toni was inducted into the Women's Sports Hall of Fame. March 6th was recognized as Toni Stone Day in her hometown of St. Paul, Minnesota. And also in her hometown, there was a baseball field named after her. And a play about Toni Stone was written by Lydia Diamond and premiered in 2019. Toni was quoted as saying, "I'll sum it this way, live a dream. Women just got as right living the dream as the boys. When the role is called up yonder, I want to play baseball." And now we come to one of the greatest players in the Negro Leagues, and I'm proud to say a native Austinite. This is Willie Wells. Willie Wells was born in 1906 here in Austin, Texas. He started his career playing baseball as a bat boy, being a bat boy for the Austin Black Senators. He made his debut in Negro Leagues in 1924 with the St. Louis Stars. He went on to play for such teams as the Detroit Wolves, the Homestead Grays, the Kansas City Monarchs, the Newark Eagles, the New York Black Yankees, Indianapolis Clowns. He ended his season in 1948 playing for the Memphis Red Sox. When he wasn't playing Negro League baseball in the United States, he barnstormed and played in Mexico and Central America. He played for such teams in Mexico. He played at Veracruz, Tampico, and Mexico City. His plate appearances, he appeared at the plate 3,144 times. His batting average was .319. His slugging percentage was .510, and he hit 100 home runs. He also taught Jackie Robinson how to steal a base. Willie Wells was known as El Diablo, the devil, because he was so fast. And Willie Wells has the distinction of being in the Baseball Hall of Fame and also in the Mexican Baseball Hall of Fame as well, the Latin American leagues.
Thank you.
Downs Field is named for Dr. Carl Downs. Dr. Downs was a graduate of Samuel Houston College in 1930, and in 1943, he became the president of Samuel Houston College. As president, Dr. Downs significantly increased the enrollment. When he came to Samuel Houston College in 1943, the enrollment was 174. At the time of his death in 1948, after 4.5 years as president, the enrollment was 600. Dr. Downs was well known as a college educator and a Methodist minister at the Scott Methodist Church in Pasadena, California. He established community services to gain widespread attention, especially services focusing on supporting children. Also, while he was in Pasadena, he also started an interracial forum that included recitals and seminars, and these were highly regarded in Pasadena, California. When he came to Austin, he continued to work, and he worked with the ministry of Wesley United Methodist Church in establishing forums, which also included recitals and lectures. I've seen one of the programs from those forums, and W.E.B. Du Bois was a featured speaker at one of those forums in the 1940s. There was one young man who visited the Scott Methodist Church where Dr. Downs preached in Pasadena, and Dr. Downs really became a mentor for this young man. Dr. Downs even served as the officiant at the young man's wedding. In 1943, this young man, fresh from Fort Hood, originally from Georgia, was recruited by Dr. Downs to be the coach of the basketball team and the track team at Samuel Houston College. This man went on to play in the Negro Leagues, including the Kansas City Monarchs. He was then recruited to the Montreal Royals, the minor league team for the Brooklyn Dodgers, and soon became a Dodger, number 42. That young man was Jackie Roosevelt Robinson. Now, while Jackie Robinson was coach at Samuel Houston College, he coached the basketball team as well as the track team. And during exhibition games involving the basketball team, if the basketball team was rather short on men, he would sometimes get into the games and play basketball alongside the players whom he coached. Although he never played here, we like to think that he walked across the field. Next up, we have a poem honoring Jackie Robinson. Take it away, Scott Free.
Jackie Robinson steals home. That's right, folks. Jackie Robinson steals home. He was Joe Louis in a ball cap. With the dirt crunching beneath his cleats, that was his theme music, and you couldn't satchel his pages, faceless images of defenders and fans pounding their fists into their pressed palms, and maybe he was afraid. Afraid the rooted summers would grant no mercies at home, plated by the fact that he didn't belong there. So he runs. You can hear his clothes whipping in the innocence of the wind. So he runs. It's like someone was chasing him, praising the galloping gamut through a gauntlet, wearing out his tennies like his welcome, going back and forth. Every time the game set the match ablaze, they relished when he was in a pickle. Heavy-handed retaliations. Every time they thought he was being a little bit too Sinatra to be frank about it. So they placed him in the same position as his class. Second, a black face. Blazing for the Brooklyn bums with a shotgun and a map to Canada in his back pocket. He takes off a third, legs churning like the butter at Big Mama's house as a child. He remembers the instant the rude moment slows. And he sees the children beneath the stands, between the forest of ankles and legs, believing not what they see, but only empathizing with the price of this freedom, wondering, was he safe for stealing a plate on the field or trying to field a plate in the state of Mississippi? Either way, it was a catch 42. He was birthed by the bricks, built by the stones that the builder refused, standing up in a puff of dancing dust, wiping off the dirt like death threats. But damn, How many bases does a man have to steal before he finds home? And apparently, serving your country doesn't get you served in your country, but hey, I digress. With a suicide lead from third, and exhausted from the Spurs being cast from the stands, with his final destination tickling his fancy, so with a borrowed breath and hope soaking in his shoes, he runs. For our children being broken and thrown to the bedrock, he runs. With the evanescence of fate driving him to the plate, he runs, dodging the intersection of callous mercies so that those children buttoned beneath the stands could one day find their hope safe. Safe. Jackie Robinson is finally safe.
Hello, everyone. My name is Cindy Elizabeth, and I'm a documentary photographer and visual artist born and raised in East Austin. For this collaboration with Forklift and the Downsfield community, I had the opportunity of creating portraits for a series entitled Downsfield, A Beautiful Symphony. As a child, I spent a lot of time passing by Downsfield and looking through the fence, watching the players on the field perform what at the time looked to be some form of synchronized movements to the amusement of their coaches and sometimes an assortment of fans. And though I didn't fully understand the mechanics of baseball at the time, I knew that it always felt special to sneak a peek through that fence every now and again. Recently, I had the opportunity to finally come from behind the fence and set foot onto the field to co-create a symphony through imagery with some historical figures who helped shape the history of Downsfield, as well as some players who currently call Downs their home and are helping to lay the foundation for the future of the field, as well as the game of baseball. Through that process, I felt the same sense of magic again. I heard all kinds of stories from former Negro League players about playing in the league at Downsfield as well. Alan Hicks, who played for the Kerrville All-Stars, joked about how different Downsfield looks now compared to what it looked like when his team used to play there. He said it was nothing but dirt and pockets of grass back in the day, but they still got out there and they handled their business. So he was so amazed at how much the field had changed. This series of images that I am about to share with you celebrates the legacy of former Negro League players like Alan Hicks and uplifts current members of Houston Tillotson's baseball team, adding to this orchestra of sound and movement. The last layer this series explores are the future generations of players who, as a result of the groundwork laid by the Negro League players in Texas, are able to imagine their role in the sport, on Downsfield and in the world. This series of portraits will be hanging up along the fences of Downsfield soon, so please stay tuned for more updates on that and more details to come on that. You can follow me on Instagram at Cindy Elizabeth Photo. And until then, I have prepared a virtual exhibit to share with you today. Enjoy.
My name's Lefty O'Neill. I played for the San Antonio Black Sox. I also played for the Biloxi Dodgers of the Gulf Coast Southern League. Total years, 4.5 years. I was a pitcher, left-handed pitcher. And later on in my life, when I wasn't playing, I was an instructor for pitching, teaching people how to pitch without hurting their arms. And that led me into scouting baseball, Major League Baseball.
My name is Lawrence Tucker, better known as Fireball. I played with the San Antonio Black Sox, the San Antonio Reds, and the San Antonio Outlaws. And I'm a pitcher.
My name is Willie Hale. Friends call me Big Ray or Big Bruiser, depending on which side of the tracks you lived on. And I'm talking about that track right out there behind the field. I got started here as a bat boy with the Austin Greyhounds when I was in the first grade. And I went all the way from the first grade to the 12th grade being a bat boy. And I guess about the 10th grade, I ended up switching teams. I was a bat boy for the Austin Indians.
My name is Lawrence Johnson. I played for the San Antonio Black Sox back in the day. And it really was a rewarding experience playing for the guys. Because one thing, you get a chance to meet a lot of people and develop a bond with the guys.
My name is Alan Hicks. I was a catcher for the Kerrville All-Stars. And I guess you would say I'm the backstop.
When I started playing ball, when I was like 15 and 16, it was a fella named William Pitt. He taught me how to play shortstop and second base. He said, "Now, Lawrence, can you dance?" I said, "Yeah, I can dance a little bit." He said, "Well, show me your moves and stuff for us dancing." Now, this relates to baseball now, which I'm going to get to. So I started. He said, "Show me your rhythm." I started doing that. He said, "No, move your feet from side to side." So I started moving my feet and stuff like that. He said, "That's what you're going to have to do when a base runner comes from first base down to second base, because this job is to take you out." So, in other words, if you develop the moves and the dance, so when you get the ball and receive it, throw it and jump and get out the way. You the base runner, you coming down, you got to get out the way. So what I would do, and throw the ball, you see. And it relates, but a lot of people don't realize that.
I was playing for the Air Force team in Mississippi, and I pitched against the Gulf Coast Negro Leagues. So after the game was over with, the owner went to my coach and asked if they could sign me on a contract and pay me after our season's over. But I remember walking through that gate, and I was a starting pitcher. All I could smell was popcorn, all food. But the biggest thing was I smelled the grass. And when I smelled the gloves and the grass, the rawhide, it just was a special feeling for me. And of course, it was special because of who I was playing for, too, because the Greyhounds hated us. And here I am going to be the starting pitcher on the mound, and they don't know about me. And I'm out there with a different color, and they're trying to figure this out. And again, we've been very good friends since then. And then the other thing is when I got on the mound, there was dead silence. It was loud as it could be. I got on the mound, nobody said anything. Music stopped. And they're staring at me, and I thank God our catcher, Concho Coleman. Concho comes out and said, why aren't you throwing the ball? I said, "They're staring at me." He said, "Throw the freaking baseball. Just throw the ball. I'll take care of them."
I started out with the San Antonio Outlaws. I was in the military, and I came home on leave, and they said, "Do you want to play ball?" And I say yes, because my grandfather was a catcher with baseball, and it was one of them things that I wanted to do, so I did it. I can remember it was extremely hot, but you had a game to play. There were all kind of betting going on, whether or not they would reach first base, whether they would go to second base. Everything that would make no sense to you as a pitcher, but it was fun.
A lot of times I would come down with my uncle, and we would cut the grass right before the game. He would purposely let it grow during the week and cut it the day of the game. And after that, the players would start coming in, and I would start warming up with the players, so I learned how to catch a baseball coming fast as a kid. And the smells when you come in that gate, first thing I said when I came in that gate a while ago was, "Where are the hot dogs?" Like I said, I live right across the tracks over here, and I could smell those hot dogs cooking from here over to my house. And the chili, we used to call it 10-pound chili, because they put about 10 pounds of sugar in that chili. You would eat those hot dogs and you couldn't understand, "I need another hot dog, man." You were hooked on that chili. You were going to go back and get another hot dog because that sugar was calling you back every time. Now, as a little kid, you know, I was smart enough to go underneath those bleachers. And a lot of times the guys would, you know, drop their money down underneath the bleachers, and they would give me a quarter to go there and get it for them. And when he said he came out on the mound and it got quiet, dead quiet, the reason it got dead quiet because nobody had ever seen him play before. They didn't know what kind of pitcher he was going
to
be.
They didn't know what to do with him.
They didn't know how to bet. So they were like, "What do we do now?" So they had to watch that first pitch. And if it popped that glove, pow, then it went back to normal. Everybody went to talking and betting.
Well, I started my baseball career in Kerrville, Texas in 1953. that what they call a little league baseball. That's when it first started, as I know of. And I was on one of the first teams out of Kerrville. And from little league, I went to Pony League. In Pony League, I played in high school. In high school, right on into the All-Stars. And then from the All-Stars, I was drafted in the military. And after they found out I played a little ball, I played divisional ball for the military. And that was pretty much like playing pro ball. Practice twice a day and go home to your family. And what I remember about this field is whenever we got the game, whenever we come on the field, it was sort of like being pro players. I mean, you had a certain feeling in you that just makes you just pep up. Now, that first inning, I got them butterflies now. Them butterflies come in there now. But after that first inning and them butterflies are gone, I'm gonna give you a ball game.
I started playing softball when I was like 14 years old, 13, 14 years old on Rosewood Park. And Nevada Durst, who used to also have a radio station, he was a coach. And at that time, you know, we played at Rosewood Park, and we traveled pretty much all over Central Austin and everything. We were champs, called the Barbettes. And my brother named it the Barbettes because he was a barber, and he was our manager. We played at Rosewood Park. And eventually, we did start playing down at Downfield. I played third base and also left field. I was the fourth batter. If everybody else gets on base before you, first, second, third one, gets on base, it's your job to bring them all in to make the home run. And I did pretty good at doing that.
My name is Michael Hearn II. I'm going into my third full year as head coach at Houston Tillis University. I'm from Houston, Texas. I actually transferred over here from Preview A&M and played ball here in 2008-09. I'm an alumni from here as well, graduated from here in 2011. Just excited to see the turnaround, bring this baseball program back to where it was when I was here.
Going from high school to playing here was kind of an eye-opening experience back then. And I mean, for me, it kind of fueled the fire for me coming back as a coach later on after I got done playing, just wanted to turn it around. HD did a lot of good things for me, started my college career, so why not come back and get back to it?
Favorite thing about coaching is being able to help kids chase their dream of playing minor league baseball, playing college baseball at that, to help them still learn the game and perfect their craft as they continue to go on and so forth after college.
Grady Stalks has been around since 1976. I actually played for Grady Stalks in 1976. It was considered as Little Downs. We played our football games on Big Downs in the outfield. We offer baseball, softball, football, and cheerleading.
I think the Little League will give our youth a sense of accomplishment. They learn a lot as far as being a team player, which will help them in life. Learning how to win and lose, and lose gracefully at different things, and still be able to get back on your feet and move forward and not just give up.
When we would come and show up, they would go to dancing up in the stands and say, the Black Sox is here, the Black Sox is here. Dancing, yep. Playing instruments, and having a good time.
We were definitely a show in Negro League Baseball. This was an art to me. Baseball's an art. And that's why I think it's America's pastime more than any other sport.
So without further ado,
coming up next,
fresh off the presses,
world debut,
new for your ears, Home Field.
It was a gathering spot,
but so much more. Like going to the grandest social occasion.
And a game broke out.
It was home.
Dirt and cleats stirring up dust devils, where lessons were learned, filaments burned light on the base paths.
The field catcalled past the streetlight glow. We have gathered at this home for nearly 100 years.
Jump swing with the drum line from the East Austin Foundation. Solace is what some find on the east side of things.
No little occasion for the players who played.
No little social occasion for the players being praised or the shouts being raised.
He hit it!
She struck him out!
What a catch!
Hallelujah!
Where would you rather be than here?
Well, some caught passes, others caught feelings.
High school sweethearts wrestle with adult dealings, where the grass is greener and you can always find the good foot.
You might not have been born and raised here, but you got here as soon as you could to see the black pioneers of the black senators.
Greyhounds and Indians and Palominos.
Houston Tillis and Rams baseball.
Anderson Yellow Jacket high school football.
Pee-wee football and band practice.
Hide and seek.
But you better not go past the railroad tracks. So a tip of the cap to some of the greatest baseball players that you've never heard of.
Willie Wells, El Diablo, Smokey Joe Williams. Tony Stone.
Who throws like a girl.
Because she was. And the ones you do remember.
Buck O'Neill, Satchel Paige, Willie Mays.
They played in a league of their own, and we cannot forget who they are.
Or what they did. They were the East Side kids.
What we must do is clear. Remember.
Turn our memories into mosaics.
Moments into monuments.
Stories into stones. Building foundations that will last through the years.
Foundations of a home.
Welcome to Downsfield.
Woo! That was incredible. Moments into monuments. I love it.
It was great.
Thank you, Alan and Scott Free, for your words.
Thank you to Cindy Elizabeth for your beautiful portraits of the people of this field.
And guess what? You can still see Cindy's portraits along the fence at Downs Field starting soon. So mask up, use your hand sanitizer, jump on your bike, or take a walk on the East Link Trail, or drive over to Downs Field and see her work. It's worth your time.
And thank you to Harrison Epright for dropping that history knowledge on us and for the ever important context for this place and our city.
And HT's pitching coach, Ryan Simpson, for getting us moving and getting around today.
Thanks to the Six Squared team, Regine, Shelby, and Lauren.
And much love to the Forklift team, Chrissy and Gretchen and team. We love working with you.
Thanks, Pam. Hakeem Adewumi's photos were in the very beginning that you saw today. And also big shout out to Justin Humphrey for taking us to Downs with the magic of video. We have an incredible advisory team too. So thank you all for your love and commitment to the field. And a shout out to our partners, HT Baseball, the City of Austin Parks and Recreation Department, and their Historic Preservation and Heritage Tourism Program.
And the Austin History Center, Community Archives with Kimberly Keaton, the Texas Playboy Sandlot, Preservation Austin, KAZI 88.7, and Austin PBS. We have a lot of great partners, don't we, Chrissy?
We do, and we have some awesome funders too. So thank you to all of our funders, the St. David's Foundation, the Moody Foundation, Austin Community Foundation, Austin Parks Foundation, the Alice Clayburgh Reynolds Foundation, Texas Commission on the Arts, and the City of Austin Cultural Arts Division.
And we want you to keep in touch with us. So visit us on Instagram. Our handle is @sixsquare.atx and Forklift Danceworks. And on our website, sixsquare.org and forkliftdanceworks.org.
We definitely want you to keep up with what we're doing, and we also would love your support.
Absolutely. And guess what else? Speaking of baseball, we all need to be on the field to make sure we vote. The deadline to register to vote is on Monday. Make sure you hit it out of the park and do that.
Make sure you, your friends, and your family are ready to go.
Absolutely. So stay tuned. When the video pops up, press play, get your snacks, hydrate, come on back,
and be ready to have a conversation.
We'll talk with Cindy, Harrison, and our slam poets. See you in a second.